of the English alphabet and we're into the Greek alphabet. And so now we're looking at a storm in the Gulf. And so, which is another reason why our protection of our forests and trying to curb global warming is so very, very important. Just to give you a little background, I am the chairman of the Environmental and Climate Justice Committee for the NAACP National Board of Directors, where I have governance and oversight over our organization's environmental and climate justice policies, as well as I'm the co-founder for a Gulf regional-based organization, the Education, Economics, Environmental, Climate, and Health Organization. That's a regional, Gulf regional-based organization, as I mentioned. And I call this my opportunity to strictly do frontline work because the work in the Gulf South, in the Southeast U.S. is so very important. We have very unique challenges in this part of the nation. And certainly the area where I live is more disproportionately prone to climate disaster than any other area in the nation. I am a survivor of Hurricane Katrina that destroyed my home, practically destroyed my home. I had a 78% loss of my home in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina, which I'm grateful that, you know, when you consider some people lost 100%, some people were left with only a slab. 5 years after Hurricane Katrina, and I will mention that way that this work became so personal for me is that during Hurricane Katrina, I lost two of my dearest friends to drowning death. They lived a little closer to the Gulf beachfront, and they had stayed in their home after Hurricane Camille, and they thought that they would be safe because at that time they thought Camille would be the worst storm that we would ever see. And they stayed in their home. And as the waters from Katrina rapidly rushed into their home, even climbing into their attic was not enough to save them from drowning. So I was able to rebuild my home, but you're never able to replace the lives that are lost when you have these climate disasters. 5 years after Hurricane Katrina, I was able to walk down to the beachfront and see all the sludge from the BP oil spill. Not long after that, maybe a few months or so after that, the NAACP issued its cold-blooded report, which researched 378 coal-fired plants across the nation. And in reading that report, I discovered that one of those coal-fired plants was actually in my backyard, less than 4 miles from my home. So that is what I call a take your earrings off moment. Those of you who have not heard of Tyler Perry's Don't Make a Black Woman Take Her Earrings Off, that was the moment that I was called. Those were moments that called me to actions. And from that day forward and those days forward, my civil and human rights advocacy, which began as a child, as a matter of fact, when I was 10 years old, I had the opportunity to meet Dr. Martin Luther King. So as a child, I grew up in the Deep South during segregation and has seen this evolve, and my advocacy has evolved to now a focus on environmental and climate justice. So let me talk a little bit about biomass, about our forests and protecting our forests. Right now, I'm engaged in a campaign here locally in Gulfport, where our city is attempting to build a connected road. And in the process, they're gonna destroy about 100 acres of wetlands. And then that is going to lead to a much larger development to where it will destroy another 600 acres of wetlands, which we know will exacerbate flooding It's going to bring about pollution. It's going to bring about water contamination. And so our forests are so important. Our wetlands are so important. And the thing that brought me into this work, as far as it relates to wood pellets and biomass, I have been doing a lot of global work on behalf of the NAACP and ECHO for the last, I have attended the last 7 years of United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change Conference of Parties. My first one was in Warsaw, Poland, and the following year, Lima, Peru. The following year, I was honored to be in Paris, France, when they negotiated the Paris Climate Agreement. The following year, 2016, I'll never forget, because I was in Marrakesh, Morocco, because that was the election year. And the following year, and every year, and last year, I was actually the liaison for the United States delegation for the Climate Action Network. So I'd heard a lot at these UN conferences about biomass. I'd heard a lot of the debates, especially from scientists, and I've seen those debates evolve from when I first attended my first COP in Warsaw to scientists being not really sure. Some were in favor, to now, you know, many, many scientists being vehemently opposed to biomass. But I had only, my knowledge of biomass was basically from the aspect of the utilizing the burning for fuel in, not the manufacturing, because you really don't hear that in the global settings. So this has given me an opportunity to uplift that advocacy from the cutting to the delivery, because now on this end, our U.S. forests are mostly being used there for biomass, and then they're being transported to different countries. And a couple of years ago, we were at a climate reality conference in Atlanta, Georgia, and one of our youth board members of ECHO had an opportunity to meet Emily from Dogwood Alliance and maybe some other people from Dogwood Alliance. And then he came back and to let me know that they were proposing to have the world's largest biomass plant built right here 65 miles from my home in Lucedale, Mississippi. And of course, it was something that we challenged. But one thing that I've learned about our Mississippi Department of Environmental Quality is that once any project goes before them, because our state is so economically desperate, that as long as your I's are dotted and your T's are crossed on paper, you will be permitted. So there was never any doubt in my mind that we would be permitted. So I am actually involved in advocating against biomass and the destruction of our forests on a local, regional, national, and international level. And one of the reasons that we're having this on international level, and one of the things it is very crucial. It's very crucial that we heed the Paris Climate Agreement and the International Panel on Climate Change, Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report that we need to get well below 1.5 degrees centigrade. Pollution begins, though, and ends with people, and so must our policies. So while we're demanding, and rightfully so, to stay well below 1.5 degrees Celsius, we, to save our planet, and I hope I said Celsius the first time, we must strive to stay well below 1.5 unemployment to save our people. We must demand lowering the poverty rates to stay well below 1.5. We must demand to keep our school dropout rates well below 1.5. We must demand to lower our incarceration rate well below 1.5. We must demand to keep our tree clearing rates well below 1.5%. We must keep pollution emissions well below 1.5. We must demand lowering our mortality rate. We must demand equal rates and pay for all. And all of these demands are, and most people want to say, well, what does this have to do with forest justice? Well, all of this has to do and has some, in some part, to do with systemic racism, with systemic oppression, because at the end of the day, people who are most disproportionately impacted are low income and are people of color. So when we look at other countries, and I see countries who will boast about getting their emissions lowered, and they have these plans to get their emissions lowered to well below the 1.5 degrees. And that's very admirable, but we cannot do it by any means necessary. And what is happening here is that we are doing it by imperiling our states in the Southeast. Most of these states, and I usually, if I'm making a presentation, I have a slide in there where I will show, if you see, if you go and look at a photo of the cotton trade states, which was fueled by the slave trade, and you look at a picture of the wood pellet trade states, they are virtually almost the same states. And so we have to look at this system of oppression that continues to manifest itself. And even though the intentions are good, we have to call out the injustice when it comes to manufacturing these wood pellets, which are destroying our forests, while these other countries where we're shipping the, our forest products to burn for energy, this is being, it's imperiling people of color, and we have to demand that they not look the other way. So I am certainly involved from the human rights perspective in the advocacy in countries who are using this and raising the visibility as it relates to the social sciences involved as it relates to biomass. So today we do have some great panelists. We will be looking at and hearing some great presentations today. We will be having a question and answer period, and then we'll have public question period, and then we'll have our closing. So I'm going to get right into introducing our first speaker for today, which is Danna Smith. Danna founded Dogwood Alliance back in 1996 to fight against the impacts of industrial logging on the environment, economy, and communities of the South. Dogwood Alliance has transformed the practices of some of the largest consumers of paper in the world, as well as four of the top five paper producers, increasing protection for over 90 million acres of southern U.S. forests. She is a leading voice connecting the dots between climate change, forest destruction, and environmental justice, and pushing for forest protection in the U.S. at a scale necessary to meet the sustainability challenges of the 21st century. Danna?
Awesome. Thanks so much, Kathy. Thanks for sharing a little bit about yourself and your experience in this realm too. We got to get real about what's really going on here in the U.S. with our forests. I grew up in the world's largest wood producing region. And just to be clear, I didn't grow up in Brazil or Indonesia. I grew up in the coastal plain of the southern U.S. on the coast of South Carolina. I grew up smelling pollution from the paper mill every time we crossed the Savannah River Bridge. And I remember coming home and feeling a sense of relief of being able to breathe clean air and feeling a sense of gratitude for not living next to that monstrous facility. I saw huge swaths, 10 acres at a time, 20 acres, 250 acres, 400 acres, that were once incredibly diverse forests where I used to hunt and hike with my dad, laid barren and replaced with rows upon rows of loblolly pine seedlings. I know all too well, I've seen it, the way the forest industry and large landowners dominate local politics in the name of jobs and the economy and taking care of the forest, while visibly seeing how rural communities at the epicenter of the impacts of this industry are in constant decline, struggling to make ends meet. I've seen firsthand the wealth disparity and how it's carved clearly along racial lines in these rural communities, how it's drawn between those that own land and those that do not. And I've seen the way in which the concerns, ideas, and voices of those who don't own land are consistently discounted, ignored, and tossed aside by our government officials, academic institutions, and others in our society. I've also seen the way that science is likewise ignored consistently if it happens to illuminate some negative impacts of the forest industry. 25 years of doing forest protection work in the world's largest wood producing region, and I have seen all of these things firsthand. It's awesome to see all of you here from across the country coming to join this webinar. It's also amazing to see forests are becoming increasingly a part of new climate and green jobs policy proposals. I think that is a hopeful sign that finally, forests are seen as a vital climate solution. People are now thinking about how forests relate to some of the other crises that we face, the widespread health and economic disparities, and the institutional racism that our country is now having to confront. At the same time, there's a really dangerous thing happening right now in our country as it relates to forests. There's a lot of conversation about the benefits of forests, how they pull carbon out of the atmosphere, how they help store carbon, how they can help shore up natural flood control, how they protect our watersheds and provide clean water, wildlife habitat, recreation, and all of these things. But there is an elephant in the room that too many people working in the space of forests don't want to confront, and that is the impacts of the forest industry on climate and low-income communities and communities of color. The U.S. is the world's largest producer and consumer of wood products. The scale of logging in the southeastern U.S. region alone is 4 times that of South American rainforests. This is having significant impacts on climate. Bill's going to talk about that later. It's having significant impacts on communities. Leo's going to lift up some of those stories and some of those impacts. I think the bottom line here is that the failure to acknowledge these impacts reflects a willingness on the part of too many to continue to put the interests of corporations and large landowners ahead of the health and well-being of certain communities and the planet. The most egregious example right now is how wood is rapidly being put forward as a green, climate-friendly solution to coal and gas. The U.S. South has become not only the world's largest producer of paper, but is also now the world's largest exporter of wood pellets. Community concerns about the pollution and the destruction have gone on deaf ears. Our policymakers have ignored the scientists who are raising concerns about the devastating impact of this on climate change. We've seen companies like Enviva steamroll mill after mill through the permitting process against the will of the people who suffer the most direct impacts. This problem is also manifesting and can be found in policies that are promoting wood as a natural climate alternative to steel or plastics. It can be found in policies that promote logging as a solution to the wildfire issue out west, ignoring vital science that's showing that logging is actually making things worse. Any forest-related climate and green jobs policy proposal that fails to acknowledge or address climate and community impacts associated with the forest industry is perpetuating climate chaos and is complicit and the direct harm that is being done to low-income and communities of color. This is why we're holding this webinar today. We need people to really think about how to discern between solutions that are truly green versus those that are greenwashing. We need people to tell the difference between policies that truly understand that Black lives really do matter and those that simply perpetuate the current systems of power, wealth, and influence. We have to get forest policy right. We have to embrace the impacts that this industry is having on our forests and communities. If we don't, we might as well throw in the towel on climate justice. We can do this. It's not rocket science. It's not like building some new technology that's never been tried. Forests are such a critical solution, but what it requires us to do, which is really challenging, is to confront and acknowledge the injustice that is taking place to people and to our natural world. So I'll hand it back to you, Kathy, to introduce our next speaker.
Thank you so much, Danna. Thank you, Danna, I'm sorry. Our next speaker, Reverend Leo Woodberry, has been an environmental justice champion since the early 90s. He helped bring the Ku Klux Klan to justice in South Carolina. That was many, many years ago. That's something we have in common. We both kind of grew up in the civil rights movement. He has organized low income and Black communities around water quality issues, including halting the construction of the PD coal plant. And he has served on the steering committee of the People's Climate Movement. His nonprofit, New Alpha Community Development Corporation, has been influential in creating the South Carolina State Energy Plan. Reverend Leo.
Yes, thank you so much, Katherine, and thank you, Danna, for that great overview. I think that the title of this webinar is very, very important, and we're so thankful for all of you who have decided to join this webinar. Why do I say this? Because when we look at forests, climate, and justice, we are truly talking about a perfect storm where the winds of change can blow and the waters can wash away false solutions and actually water the seeds for community-based solutions that can turn the situation that we're in right now that is bringing about harm not only to our forests, our communities, but also to our climate and our entire planet. You know, as someone who does the work on the ground every day, you know, I'm familiar with the science, I'm familiar with organizing and policy, but where you really want to see the damage that is being done is to go to the communities where the forest industry, where clear cutting, where logging, where biomass facilities actually work and where they actually take place. So when I think about that, I think about the little town of Nichols, South Carolina, that was flooded not once, not twice, but three times during 2015, during the what they call the thousand year flood, during Hurricane Matthew, during Hurricane Florence. And when we went there after Hurricane Matthew and before and after Hurricane Florence, you could see all of the forests, all of the trees, even some of the wetlands that had been cut down by widespread logging. And the many communities, the elderly people who, when you tour the 5-mile stretch and you just look for 5 miles and only see three houses that people are living in because they can't afford to continue to repair their homes over and over again. Today, the town of Nichols has 2/3 of its population gone. because people could no longer afford to keep repairing their homes. And finally, the state of South Carolina issued buyouts. And not only were homeowners impacted, but I think about Reverend Bobby Rogers, who said to me, sadly, you know, every young person I have in my church is gone. I have no one left but elderly people on fixed incomes who can't afford to move. We can see it when we go to Southwest Georgia and Albany, Georgia, where farmers are talking about how much of their crops they are losing and how much more intense the flooding has become because of widespread logging in their communities. And we see it when we go to a little place called Britain's Neck in South Carolina, where my family is from, where we've had close to 2,000 people evacuated three times in the last 5 years because the wetlands and the rivers that they are in between continue to flood. And once again, people tell us the flooding is worse ever since the logging began. And on your way down to Britain's Neck, on your way to Nichols, on your way to Albany, Georgia, instead of seeing natural forests, you see rows and rows and rows of trees that make up pine plantations. So why is this a perfect storm? Because we need the winds of change to blow. We need to wash away the injustices where the forest industry, where biomass industry purposely seek out communities that they know are impoverished, that they know are filled with people of color. Communities where people have to drive 30 and 40 miles one way every day, working for minimum wage, making hospital beds, working in retail stores. And then we look at the biomass industry even closer with the pollutants that they put out. We can go to Greenwood, South Carolina, where they're now requesting a permit to expand their plant. And we hear people talking about the debris that's in their pools, the sawdust that they have to wash off of their cars and their window. The people who talk about having respiratory problems, not before the plant was created, but once the plant was built. And this is particularly concerning when we're talking about a global pandemic, because when we look at African Americans, for example, we see that they have a disproportionate number of illnesses that make them more susceptible to COVID. Asthma, respiratory problems, high blood pressure, diabetes, while they reside in communities that are labeled food swamps and food deserts, they also have to contend with the particulate matter that flies off of logs as they're brought into the biomass plant owned by Enviva. They have to deal with the pollution that comes from their smokestacks. They have to deal with the diesel fumes that come from the trucks that bring them in. And what does that mean for the South? Katherine mentioned that this is the same thing. It's the same old deal, just like this slave trade industry. We look at Enviva and we see them targeting low-income communities, people of color communities, in a plan where they announce to their shareholders a plan where they want to construct 13 more biomass facilities in southern states. And so in a perfect storm, we have to realize that we wash away dirt, we wash away debris, we wash away the old world. And if I can take a quote from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and adapt it for our times, he said that we were facing a triple threat of poverty, racism, and militarism. Today, in the South, I say we face a triple threat as well. And that triple threat is extractive energy, like frack gas, biomass wood pellet, and the wood pellet industry, and climate deniers and climate delayers. But one thing that happens after a storm has passed is this: the sun shines again, plants grow, the earth flourishes. So let us realize the intersectionality of forest, climate, and justice. And if we bring those things together, the sun will shine again, communities will prosper once again, and we'll build a new economy, a new world that will be built not on false solutions, but on our forests, our natural environment, and people who are healthy and safe. Thank you so much. Katherine, back to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Reverend Leo, so very, very much. He is always such an inspiration because Reverend Leo usually always puts this in a context to where you're looking at this from a moral perspective. Now let's get this scientific perspective from Dr. Bill Moomaw, who has been working on climate change since 1988 as the first director of the climate program at the World Resources Institute. He has been a lead author of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, IPCC report, one of which was jointly awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2007. And I want to mention, Dr. Bill, those are my go-to, two of my go-to places when I'm seeking information, WRI and IPCC. He is currently working on natural solutions to climate change with a focus on increasing carbon dioxide removal and sequestration by forests, wetlands, and soil. Dr. Bill.
Let me get on here. Thank you very much, Katherine. As I was listening to you, I was very impressed with your the amount of climate conference hopping you have done. You have done more than I have. it's very impressive what you have accomplished, and I'm very honored to be part of this. And I'm also very pleased to have been able to work with Danna Smith and with Leo Woodberry, who have not only done remarkable things themselves, but from my point of view, they have been extremely helpful in having me be part of their effort, that I can be their go-to science person, and I connect them with other scientists. Let's see, I can't share my screen until someone stops sharing the screen that's on here now, I guess.
We've got your slides queued up, Bill, so you can...
Oh, they are? Okay, yeah. All right, okay, good. So you're gonna run them through for me. Okay, go ahead. Okay, you have the first one up there? I can't see them for some reason. Oh, here we are, that's good. Back last year, in November, four colleagues and I published this paper. At the time it was published, in fact, it was published just one day after President Trump announced he was pulling the U.S. out of the Paris Agreement that Katherine pointed out how it was so important we'd be part of. And in this paper, basically 11,000 scientists signed it and said, yes, we agree with this. And since then, another 2,600 scientists have agreed with it, and they come from 156 countries. Next slide, please. And just to, for those of you who may not be following that closely, this is just showing the line is the rise of carbon dioxide, and the blue lines are temperatures of the world that are cooler than the average between about 1950 and 1980, and the red ones are all the warmer ones. And it turns out that 19 of the 20 warmest temperatures for the world have been since the year 2000, and the only one that's not is in 1998. Next, please. This is just a depressing picture of everything you've been hearing about. The fires in California, the heat in Death Valley, there it is, 130 degrees Fahrenheit with a fellow with an ice pack on his head. On the right is a storm surge up here in the Northeast where I live. The bottom left, there's that's the bottom of a reservoir in California during a drought a few years back. And there you see the whirling, terrifying hurricane with its eye heading towards the coast of Florida and the Gulf Coast. And this year, as Katherine pointed out, we have had more hurricanes that have intensified more rapidly than any time in history. And to top it all off, we have an increase in the intensification of precipitation, whether that's rain or snow. Snow up here sometimes, we get these incredible snowstorms, but it's also precipitation. You can see in the Southeast, there is 27% more rain coming down in the top 1% of precipitation events, of rainstorms, than there was in the 1950s. And the results are shown on the right. I think that's a photo on the right is from Wilmington, North Carolina. With you just think of all that damage that is occurring for people. Next, please. The Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change in 2018 at the request of governments just basically did an analysis. What is it going to take to stay below 1.5 degrees Celsius, which is 2.7 degrees Fahrenheit? And it says that we have to reduce our heat trapping gases by 45% from 2005 levels by 2030. That's just in the next 10 years. And after that, we cannot emit more than nature can remove by 2050 to halt further increases. However, 1.5 degrees Celsius is warmer than we already are. We're at 1.1 now. That is, we're at about 2 degrees Fahrenheit. And this would let us go to almost 3 degrees Fahrenheit warmer. And that's not a good thing. So we need to do better and we need to act now. Next, please. So fossil fuels are adding all this 9.5 billion tons to the atmosphere, deforestation, another 1.5 billion. And yet forests remove about a third of all that we emit in each year. And US forests, however, only remove about just under 12% of our carbon emissions. That's because we have basically, you'll see in a moment, we have removed the very biggest trees that are the ones that remove and store the accumulate the most carbon. Next. So here is just some research that's come out that I'd like to share with you. A group in Germany under Professor Erb said that altering forest management to let more trees grow would allow global forests to accumulate twice as much carbon. And we have to be removing carbon at the same time that we're reducing our emissions from all these sources. And another study found that the largest 1% of trees in mature and older forests comprise 50% of the forest biomass worldwide. Meaning that out of every 100 trees, like you look at this picture, that big one on the right, and you look at all the other ones, and let's say there are 100 of them there, or 99 other ones there, half the carbon is in that tree because half of all the weight of wood is carbon. So a paper just came out last week in September by a group led by Susan Cook Patton that the potential for growing forests to accumulate carbon has been underestimated by a third, 32%. So there's a lot more that our forests could be doing if we weren't cutting them down and in particular burning them. Next. Next, yeah, good. So a group of two colleagues and I a year ago published a paper in which we put all this information together, and this picture tells the whole story. This happens to be a forest in my area up here in the Northeast. But you see on the left, a very large tree, next to it, a small man who actually is an expert at measuring trees. His name's Bob Leverett. He comes from Tennessee and he goes all over the East finding the biggest, oldest trees and measuring them and finding out how much carbon is in them. That's what we've teamed up to do. And you see that big tree, and next to it, you can see a small tree. And this big tree probably holds maybe, I don't know, something like 100 or 150 times as much carbon as that little tree. And so that's why we need more big trees. We have to let some of our now mid-sized trees grow to become large trees. Next, please. This just shows, you know, there's an argument that you can store a lot of carbon in wood products. The forestry industry talks about this all the time. And this shows nine different ways you can harvest a forest. And the light color at the top is if you store, if you make wood products from it. And you can see that in a clear cut, it's still less than half of the wood that is cut ends up in a wood product. And all these other ways of storing, of cutting forest, even less ends up in wood products. And on the very right is a forest with no management and no wood products. And you can see it is storing much more carbon than any of the managed forests. And that little star up there is where it would be if we let it just keep on growing. Next. Let me just correct two false assumptions. One is that burning wood for electricity is not carbon neutral and it's not climate neutral. Even if you let forests grow back, it will take them a long time. If you cut a 50-year-old forest, it'll take 50 years, if all goes well, to replace it and remove the carbon dioxide that was emitted. But during that time, there's more carbon dioxide in the atmosphere trapping heat. And therefore, a glacier will melt more because of that. And when you grow back a tree after 50 years, the glacier doesn't refreeze. So it's not climate neutral. The consequences are still there. The sea level has risen. It will not go back down. And burning wood also produces major health risks, as I'll demonstrate in a moment. And the other thing about carbon stored in wood products is there's a study again, showing how fallacious that is in just a moment. And that the estimates of how much wood products benefits are over, say, concrete and steel are overestimated by the industry by factors of between 2 and 100 times. Next, please. So this just shows what happens when you cut a forest. All the losses of carbon dioxide of the atmosphere from insects, fire, wind, drought, and conversion are those colored, the rainbow of colored wedges up at the top. And the big red part is the amount that is released during harvest. And if you look and see how much that actually is, it's greater than the amount of greenhouse gas emitted from our entire building sector in the United States. And in the right is a paper that I helped author, co-authored, but the real heavy lifting of this was done by two women forest ecologists, Tara Hutterberg and Beverly Law, both of them out in the west, northwest. And for the state of Oregon, for which we know the exact date at which they began cutting trees in the forestry industry, it was 1900. And we have data running through 2015. And we asked the question, where is all the carbon that was in the original forest in 1900 today? And it turns out just 19% of it, that little reddish wedge, is in long-lived wood products. 16%, the sort of, I don't know what that is, orange-colored one, is in landfills. And 65%, or nearly two-thirds of it, is in the atmosphere as carbon dioxide. So that's just a false argument about climate change and forest products. Next, please. And the health effects. Here are eight health organizations: the American Lung Association, the Asthma and Allergy Foundation, the National Environmental Health Association, Physicians for Social Responsibility, American Public Health Association, American Academy of Pediatrics, Allergy and Asthma Network. This is from a letter they wrote to Congress. Burning biomass creates air pollution that causes a sweeping array of human harms, from asthma attacks to cancer to heart attacks, resulting in emergency room visits, hospitalizations, and premature death. millions of infants and children, older adults, individuals with respiratory or cardiovascular disease or diabetes, and individuals with lower incomes face a higher risk of suffering serious health effects from these pollutants. As Reverend Leo pointed out, many of these people are people of color and the poorest in our society. And why we continue to allow this burning of biomass when it puts out the worst pollutants of anything we can burn in terms of these very small particulates. Next, please. So what is the greatest good for the greatest number? That's the mantra of the patron saint of forestry, Gifford Pinchot, who said, when we manage and do conservation for our forest, we should decide what's the greatest good for the greatest number. So is it forest reserves for carbon and ecosystem services? There's an enormous pine tree up my way with two climate scientists, one on either side, who work on the not just the IPCC, but a lot of the basic reports that support it. Or is it industrial production forests with hopefully longer rotation cycles of their harvesting? But here is something that is, this is what's rolling out near my home up in the Northeast. And it's even more of it is going on where you all are in the Southeast. Next, please. And click it once more. So let more grow. This is a picture of a southern wetland forest, which is being cut and harvested and turned into wood pellets that are being shipped to Europe where they're burned, counted as zero carbon, and causing air pollution there when they burn it and air pollution here when they make the pellets. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much for that informative information, and I think you answered a couple of the questions that came in the chat. That came in the Q&A. So let me remind everyone, if you have any question, I'm going to ask the panel a couple of questions, but if you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A box, not the chat. I'm not seeing the chat on my screen, but if you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A. I do believe one of the questions were I'll ask it again just for more clarity, but I believe Dr. Beal did have an opportunity to answer at least part of that question. I want to ask the panel a question. From your perspective, what is the relationship between forest, climate change, and community justice? I believe we heard a bit of that in Reverend yes. Leo's and in Danna's presentation. So would either of you like to expand on that a bit more?
You want me to answer that? I mean,
would be great. Yes.
Yeah, sure. Each of them made it pretty clear, I thought, what the what the social justice dimension is. And by the way, as you know, I'm a scientist. I also happen to be a human being and
yes.
one who cares a great deal about social justice. And it is appalling to me that somehow it always seems that whether it's making the pellets or burning them, they always seem to find a community of color in a poorer area of in a poorer neighborhood, let's say, or the poorer part of the world, in order to do it, and even aside from the bioenergy, just climate change itself, as you pointed out, it is the consequences of the changed climate, which are these intense storms and the intense precipitation adversely affect the poor. And in many parts of the country, those are poor people of color than they do others. And yet they're the people who have contributed the least to the problem. So, you know, let me just say in my human hat, I just think that's really unfair. It's wrong.
Absolutely. And I know you were one of the scientists on the IPP, and I have noticed that the IPP reports in recent years are becoming more and more about social sciences. So, you know, that's to be commendable as well. And later on, I guess if we have time permitting, I know that these plants, in Viva Adrex, one of them have something on their website actually quoting from the IPCC report. So you might want to dispel that. Okay. I'm going to ask a couple of more questions and then ask you to also mention, touch on one that was put in the chat, because we definitely need some clarity around the renewable part and how misleading that is as it relates to the science. So our next question, generally speaking, what do you think that the climate action here in the U.S., it gets it wrong on U.S. forests? And why do you think that is the case, or do you think that's the case, panelists?
Go ahead, Danna.
I was just going to say, I think it kind of falls into five buckets. The first two we've talked pretty extensively about is that there's just a failure to really fully understand the scope of the impacts that this industry is having on communities, low income and people of color in particular. It's a failure to really embrace the science that is emerging and documenting the impacts that industrial logging is having on climate change. But it's also deeper rooted than that. I think the third sort of reason why, you know, this is a bit of an uphill battle at this point is because there's been so much greenwashing and gaslighting on the part of the forest industry, you know, at a time when we need to be doing whatever it takes to turn the tide on climate change. We have, you know, a well-resourced industry lobbyist, allies, and spin masters are creating confusion and deflecting responsibility in an effort to perpetuate the status quo, essentially the status quo being a situation that they are personally financially benefiting from. So we see things like we need forest markets to keep forests in forests is one of those, you know, constant lines we hear from the forest industry, that if we don't log the forest, we won't be able to save the forest because the forest won't have any value. But it's simply not true. We can protect forests from logging and still have forests. I mean, seriously, there's lots of examples out there of where we still have forests where there's not logging going on. You know, another one is the most important thing is to keep forests as forests. You know, again, that's nothing more than a sneaky way of kind of deflecting responsibility and implying that urban sprawl and agriculture or the loss of forest to some other use is the biggest problem impacting U.S. forests. But as Bill pointed out, the forest industry and logging is having huge, large-scale impacts on forests. You know, and I could go on and on, but there are a number of sort of myths that are propped up by forest industry interests that I think too many people have really bought into. And then I think the fourth thing is just finally, you know, there are too much focus on solutions that work for Wall Street and large landowners to the exclusion of rural communities. So we want to try to figure out how to make sure that those who are currently profiting can continue to profit, but we're not providing equal emphasis on those who currently have been left behind and whose economies have been degraded because of the air pollution and the ecological destruction surrounding them. So I think that's a fourth reason. And then the final one, which I think kind of sums it all up, is that, you know, there's just a failure to hold the forest industry accountable. It's a huge economic player in the U.S., and they have a lot of influence at the local, state, and federal level.
I was going to add to that, basically what we're seeing with the forest industry and the biomass industry is what happens anytime people are oppressed and they are exploited. They come in and they remove all of the resources, the few assets that people have in impoverished communities. And you go in rural communities which don't have manufacturing, you go into rural communities that don't have retail businesses, where there's no longer farming. And the forests, the trees that they have are some of the few assets available. So here you have people who are struggling to survive, who are trying to find a way to thrive. And there are ways that it can be done. You know, Dan and I often talk about the fact that the outdoor recreation industry actually employs more people than the logging industry does and the forestry industry does. But it's the same old story of let's go in to people who are weak, people who are disenfranchised, people who have no power, and let's just exploit their assets and then leave them behind with absolutely nothing. And then the same time, putting people at greater risk in terms of their health, in terms of facing death, because they have even fewer assets. And that's what I would say is one of the main concerns. We have industries that are concerned simply about profits and not about people at all. And when we devalue anything, people, land, nature, it never turns out to be good. It's always disastrous for everyone and everything involved.
Thank you, Reverend Leo. And you said it. I think when we look at situations where we value profit over people, we're looking at greed, a lot of corporate greed. And that's very unfortunate. And it's a dangerous mix when you look at that with systemic racism, and that's a lethal cocktail. And that's what we are experiencing, along with some a bit of manipulation of our science or politicization of our science, especially as it relates to biomass. As we know, the EPA has classified it, the EPA director, not the EPA scientist, have classified it as a renewable source of energy, along with solar and wind. And this was a political designation. The EPA scientists did not weigh in on this, and they were outraged over that classification before they even had the opportunity to do their research. So again, when it's something that's motivated by profit, we can see politics coming into play with this as well. Another question before we get to the ones from the audience, what are some of the best solutions you think for some of these issues? I'll give each one of you a couple of minutes to maybe give one or two what you would call best practices or best solutions.
Well, there's several of them. You know, we're fortunate now to be working in some an indigenous community and a predominantly African-American community and looking at how we can develop engines of economic development in terms of ecotourism. You know, actually, you know about this in Mississippi, you know, the cotton fields would turn into catfish farms. You know, mm-hmm. can we create retaining ponds to help mitigate flooding, you know, and can we look at planting grasses and shrubbery and trees as a larger buffer against flooding? That fit in with the ecosystem. And there's just a whole host of things that can be done that actually will bring greater prosperity and jobs to communities that are languishing in poverty today.
Yeah, thanks for that, Leo. And we've just recently done a series of conversations with communities that we work with who are on the front lines of industrial logging across the South, because it's really important when we start thinking about solutions to really center and hear the solutions that people who have too far or too long been left out of the conversation about forests because they don't own land, without any regard to the impacts that how land is managed really impacts their daily lives. And what we've heard are a couple of key themes. One is they want to stop the expansion of dirty industry, and that includes the wood pellet industry and wood products, as well as gas pipelines and other dirty dirty facilities. That has come across so loud and clear that they don't need that kind of economic development. They don't want that kind of economic development. And they want development redirected to things that would actually help better their community, make them more healthy and more resilient against the worst impacts of climate change. So one example, as Leo has lifted up, is the outdoor recreation creates seven to 10 times more jobs than the forest industry. But if you look at some of these communities in the rural coastal plain where the logging rates are highest as they are on the planet, they've been sort of shut out of building outdoor recreation, local economies, because nobody wants to camp and hike in a clear cut or a pine plantation, and there's no publicly owned land. So that was one of the other things that was lifted up, is the need to do an investment, make some serious public investment in expanding public ownership in some of these areas, dedicated lands that are protected, that are publicly owned or community owned, so that everyone can have access to nature and build an economy that's more healthy. The other thing that I think is vital here is that we actually are transparent in reporting the emissions that are coming from industrial logging sector in the forest industry and set targets to reduce them the same way that we think about the fossil fuel industry, and redirect tax systems and structures and even the regulatory framework to really encourage and support leaving a lot more trees standing, especially those wetland forests, those trees along the rivers that are vital to protect our communities against the worst impacts of flooding.
Okay, thank you, Dan. Dr. Beal?
I think both of those sets of comments are really right on target. If you look at the way in which the industry up here has changed, the state of Maine is like the Southeast. It's been basically a fiefdom of the logging industry, and the amount of carbon per acre in Maine is less than a third of what it is in Massachusetts, which is the third most densely populated state in the United States. So it gives you a sense. I mean, it's not quite parking lot level, but it's pretty close as to what they've done. A couple of years ago, you probably are familiar with the Burt's Bees products, the lip balm and so forth. Well, the heir, the woman who helped found that passed away recently, and she cut a deal with Barack Obama before she died to give a huge area to the federal government to make, if he would designate it as a national monument. Well, the opposition in Maine was incredible. Mm. Oh, all the logging industry, everybody was pushing back against it. Well, they went ahead and did it. And guess what? While some of the sawmill towns up there have just massive unemployment and are losing population, the area around the Katahdin Woods National Monument has a vibrant outdoor recreational economy. And at the time, the then governor of Maine would not even put signs along the highway to direct people to this new national monument. But now, of course, everybody thinks it's just a great thing. And there are lots of things that can be done for economic development that do not involve extractive industries. And I think it's important that those be really be on the front burner when we move forward with our economic recovery. By the way, I just saw a text popped up that the president is withdrawing from any further discussions about any additional support for the economy in the follow-up to the CARES Act.
Wow.
So there we are. May have to wait a few months. Anyhow.
Okay, so we're gonna, these questions, since I'm looking at our time, so I'm gonna call this the lightning round and okay. Challenge our panelists to give us some lightning quick answers here. So so that we can get to as many of these questions as possible. I'm going to start with you, Reverend Leo, what are your thoughts on the carbon offset forestry programs, and what are the best and worst practices in your views on the carbon offset programs?
Carbon offset programs always make me fearful of one thing. Are we going to start redlining rural communities so that more carbon is emitted in certain places and reduced in others, and we know the places where they won't be reduced?
Okay. Danna?
Yeah, I actually worked on carbon markets and helped to push one of the first forest carbon markets across the finish line to meet the California protocols several years ago, and learned a lot in that process. And I have since come to the conclusion that carbon markets are a false solution, that it's almost impossible to show that there is actual additional carbon being removed from the atmosphere than would otherwise have been removed, that it's permanent, and that it's not just deflecting forest destruction from one forest to somewhere else. And so I just don't think that carbon markets are the solution here.
Bill?
Yes, I think, it would be there's something, an alternative to those kind of offset carbon markets, which is basically paying people for the carbon they store directly. And I think that avoids many of the problems that have occurred with the leakage and so forth that Danna referred to. And the other thing is, as important as the tropical forests are, I think they've been for Americans a diversion from the forest problems in the United States. And there's a false narrative that if we don't let them cut our forests, they'll just go someplace else and cut them. We don't have to keep expanding markets for forest products. We need to figure out some basic amount that we need, and that's it. We just don't have that model of eternal growth of the business, which cannot keep up with the non-eternal growth of forests when you're cutting them down.
Okay, thank you. Next lightning round question. Some forest industry proponents argue that young trees sequester more carbon than old mature trees, or that we need more logging to combat fire. Is there any data to counter this claim? Is the Forest Service enlightened to these issues around false narratives or pro-forestation?
Those are false narratives. It's like saying, yes, on a percentage basis, little trees grow really fast. It goes from a seed to this tall in 1 year. That's a big growth. But the total amount of carbon accumulated is what makes the difference. It's the carbon that's in the forest that's not in the atmosphere. And as you can see, a big tree already has a lot of carbon, and it continues to absorb, in many cases, an amount every year that's as large as a smaller tree that's maybe 1/10 its diameter. And in 1 year, it'll absorb that amount. That little tree will not absorb that amount. So that's a false narrative. And the thinning to prevent fires is another false narrative, because the only thing that'll prevent fires that damage structures is to manage the combustible material around the structures. And if you go out and randomly thin an area that's 10 miles away, it does nothing to reduce the risk of fire for those structures. And in fact, it's been shown that there's a less than 1% chance that you will thin the forest where it is going to burn. And the final thing is that thin forests, I used to think thinning meant they took out the little trees, but no, they take out the big trees. And anyone who's ever tried to make a fire does not start with big logs, they start with little sticks. And little trees are little sticks, and they burn more and they burn hotter than do the large trees in the big forest.
Thanks. Anyone else want to weigh in on that? And just note too that there were also about 800 scientists that wrote a letter to the European Parliament against biomass because in some cases, some people consider biomass as deadly, if not more so, than fossil fuel, than coal.
Yeah, I helped organize that effort.
Oh, great. Okay. Great letter. Okay. Next lightning round question. Our elected officials are supposed to be protecting our health, safety, and welfare, but they don't. So what is the most effective action that people of privilege can take to increase the effectiveness of natural forests, protect their own forests, give to organizations, take to the streets? What can average citizens do to help the cause? So that's a whole bunch together in one. And I'll say whoever wants to start this might want to start off with giving us a brief explanation or overview about what we mean when we talk about people of privilege.
I'll just say, you know, it starts with education. It starts with awareness for people in communities that are impacted, as well as those who are privileged. We always have to keep in mind that policymakers in this country, and hopefully after this election, are placed in positions of power by those who vote. And so an educated public is going to elect those policymakers who will make the right decisions for their constituents and not for lobbyists. And so I'll say all of that starts with education.
I would also just add, I think in terms of your question about, you know, what is privilege? And I think it's, you know, it's pretty clear from, you know, the state of the world today that people who are white and who have resources are more privileged in ways that people who are living in low-income areas and people of color are. And that is a systemic problem in our society. And so it's vital that people who do have access and influence in our current power structure stand up, challenge, and really lift up the voices of those who are being most directly impacted by this industry, and really be a part of listening to what these communities are saying and the kind of solutions that they want to see moving forward in their communities. So I also think that the anecdote to the lack of movement on the part of policymakers is to have a broad, powerful, coordinated movement of people who are pushing back. And so it's going to require everyone to get on board and to embrace the science, to embrace the justice issues, to center the voices of those most impacted and find solutions that work at that level.
Thank you. Dr. Beal?
I just say that whatever your privileged status is or is not, you start with where you are and you go to the group that you're in. So for me, that's been scientists, other scientists. That's where I can try to, and so the paper that had 11,000 signatures, the 800 letter to the European, you see a pattern here. I really think that's where we start. But you don't have to stop there. There's a coalition now between people who started out wanting to save forests and people who are concerned with social justice and scientists to work together. You know, then you start pulling it together and making it more than any one of those isolated groupings could ever accomplish. And I would agree with what both Leo and Danna said, which is, I think, you know, we should all honor John Lewis and get out and vote. I mean, I just think that's what we've got to do.
Yes. And make good trouble.
And make good trouble.
Yes.
Make the best trouble we possibly can.
Yes. And I think we've seen some of that good trouble. We've seen some unfortunate trouble. But we did see quite a bit of good trouble this year. And we've seen the power of what happens when you when the privilege unites, when everyone joins together. I never thought that I would live to see the day that Mississippi would get rid of that hideous flag. As a matter of fact, I was a named plaintiff in a lawsuit almost 20 years ago, and that still didn't do any good. I thought maybe, you know, taking legal action. But here, who would have thought eight minute and 46 second video would have our legislature to bring that flag down? But I will say that, again, that was not a matter of conscience. It was a matter of consequences. So when you look at consequences, that's when you start looking at privilege, and there's a lot of power that's used in whatever privilege that you have that can impact consequences. So I think, Adam, I'm not sure about our time here. I know that we have, we want to go ahead and pass it to you, or I don't think we have time for another question. Do we want to go ahead and pass it off to you now?
We do have till 6:30. So if there's a, we didn't pick another question, but if any of the panelists see a question in the Q&A that they would like to quickly address, I think we got just a couple minutes.
Okay, I'm looking at them, and I think two questions here that can be answered quite quickly. One is about the UK subsidies being paid to Drax to burn wood pellets. Do we think they'll be reduced in the next couple of years? And what more can we do in the US to help make sure that that happens sooner rather than later? That's one. And anyone want to take a stab at that?
Just very quickly, I know Jack Sproul, and thank you, Jack. You've been doing great things there in North Carolina. They've already agreed they're not going to, the British government has agreed they're not going to pay for any additional subsidies beyond the ones they're already paying. So that's a start. It's not just there, but right now in the Netherlands, there's a huge movement to eliminate bioenergy, and the European Parliament is struggling right now, pushing back against their forestry industry to try to change some of these practices, particularly the bioenergy. So, if they can do it in all those different languages, we ought to be able to do it with only a couple of languages on this continent.
Yes, and it's going to take us to keep uplifting our voices. As a matter of fact, I met a gentleman at a climate conference in South Africa last year from the Netherlands, and he only knew that this was a great thing that they were doing, and he was using biomass. He used biomass, and he was saying, "Well, should I feel guilty for taking a shower before I got here?" And I said, "You know, it's up to you, but I'm letting you know what happened and who's suffering because of that." Yeah. You know, you had the opportunity. And so when I saw him by the end of the conference, he was telling me that now when he goes out and looks on the river and see those wood pellets coming in, he will look at them differently. And then like a few days after I returned home, he actually had some journalists to contact me to do an interview on what's happening here. So we just got to keep our message out there.
That's right. Good.
Okay. And the other question, and I think we pretty much answered that from David Cooper, wanted to know, he said he understood that biomass was renewable. And I think that is the problem. And that's brought in a lot of confusion because it is not carbon neutral. So I think we pretty much clarified that, hopefully, for Mr. Cooper.
Yes, it's just that you know, it is not a you know, wind and solar are do not emit any carbon dioxide or anything else when they're operating.
Exactly.
It takes a little bit of, I mean, depending on how they're made, there's some emissions associated with that. But with solar, I know it's now the payback is probably a year or maybe a year and a half or something, and they've made up for all those emissions that occurred in their manufacturing. They go on for 30 years generating zero carbon electricity. With bioenergy, every time it puts out more carbon dioxide than burning coal to make the same amount of electricity or the same amount of heat. And another thing is that's immediate, that's instantaneous. and the regrowth is way in the future sometime, if it ever happens at all. We have no guarantee it will happen, right? I mean, a lot of things can happen in 50 or 100 years. And who's going to be around? I'm not going to be around. I know that. And I don't think anybody on this call is going to be around in 50 or 100 years. So I think it's just it's putting off to a future generation. It's like the nuclear waste problem. You know, we're giving it to dozens of future generations to worry about rather than fixing the problem ourselves. And we shouldn't do that.
Go ahead, Leo.
I was going to say, absolutely. Replanting is not renewing. You know, you don't have to replant the sun. You don't have to replant the wind. You know, so it's a false analogy.
Yes, it is. Yes,
okay, Danna, and then we'll.
Yeah, I was just going to say, there's a whole narrative out there around how forests are renewable and the U.S. But if we actually look under the hood, we're seeing massive loss of natural forests to plantations. So we're not really renewing natural forests. We've lost tremendous amount. We've pretty much annihilated all of our old growth intact forest landscapes. So we are not renewing old intact complex ecosystems. Again, what we are renewing are trees for commercial extraction. And there's a huge difference between that and actually highly functioning ecosystems and maintaining ecosystems that can, you know, stabilize the climate, protect us from, you know, flooding and all of those other things. So this is a narrative. This is one of those narratives I talked about earlier that's a myth about how forests are renewable.
Thank you all so much. So we are about at our closing time, and I want to thank all of our panelists. Thank you to Adam so very, very much for doing such a great job getting all of us coordinated. And I'm going to hand it over to you for our closing.
Yeah, well, thank you. Thank you, Katherine. And my name is Adam Collette. I'm the program director at Dogwood Alliance. A real honor to be one of the faces on this screen for this presentation, and to be with Danna, Bill, Leo, and you as well, Katherine, just leaders in this movement around forest, climate, and justice. I got a text while I was taking notes on the call, and they said, no one else is having these conversations around forests and climate. So thank you for doing so. And I just really feel that. And I'm going to talk about next steps and things that we can do. And, you know, the title of this presentation is The Perfect Storm. And I think there's an amazing forest analogy when we think about storms and we think about their impact and we think about the movement that we need to build to address these issues. When hurricanes come in, like Katrina or Florence or Matthew or that hit our coastlines, natural older forests really survive these storms. They protect our communities, but they survive. And how did they survive? They survive because the forest and a natural forest ecosystem is interlinked underneath the soil. They have built a foundation. They have built a foundation of connection and interconnectedness between each other. And so how are we as a movement, as a community, going to address these issues of environmental justice, of climate justice, of climate change? We are going to survive the storm of those issues by being interconnected under the soil. And it makes me think, I have a quote here I want to read before I get to the next steps, but it's from Clarissa Lewis, and it says, "In nature, everything works in collaboration. There are hummingbirds and flowers that are in such deep coordination, they need each other for survival. How vibrant and alive and successful could our movement be with such coordination and collaboration?" So in that spirit, I just want to give some next steps to folks. If you could pop up the slide. Yes, let more trees grow. So first off, everyone can go to dogwoodalliance.org/standforforest. Part of the reason that we are doing this webinar, and if you want to click through, that's fine. Part of this reason we want to do this webinar is because we have released a series of briefs and fact sheets that we have there. And so educate yourself. We're calling it the Stanford Forest Report Series. They are six briefs that are online that really bust several myths put forward by the industrial logging industry. These are resources that you can use to educate yourself to incorporate that into the advocacy. And so the second point is to build our movement. So there's a pledge that you can take, a Stanford Forest pledge that gets you involved. There's a national platform that's talking about why forest, climate, and justice matter. And then, you know, we build this movement by incorporating into these messages around forests into your own climate advocacy, your own advocacy towards environmental justice. And thank you for doing that work. And folding in forests into those narratives will make all the difference. And then third is just to deepen the connections. That is my email right there. We at Dogwood and amongst these groups would love to hear from your group, from your organization, ways that we can deepen these connections, build the roots between ourselves, and grow this movement, because in solidarity is how we win and address these issues. So I want to thank everybody for attending. Thank you to our panelists and to our moderator. You will be getting a email thank you, I believe, after this webinar was scheduled for two times. And so there's another one on Thursday, and then on Friday, everybody that attended will be getting an email with all of these resources contained, with further opportunities to stay engaged and more information on our speakers and to how to follow them on social media and to stay connected with their organizations as well. So look for that email on Friday. The webinar recording will be submitted to you at that point too, and feel free to pass it around and share it. So thank you all for attending, and I hope everyone has a beautiful evening and a good night. Bless you all.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.